But also it's an effort to connect in a way the world of publishing and scientific literature to open science. So and maybe one first marketing thing, no, one first disclaimer is I'm coming from Embo and we publish 4 journals. I'm an editor myself. And this is really how we came about all these questions. Now, we use our journals as live test tubes to our ideas and to the source data project, which is still, you know, something very much in development. But there is really nothing specific about our journals, or we don't want in any manner to restrict those tools or those resources to those 4 journals. We really want to distribute them. So it's not a commercial project in any manner. Now, if we talk about big data and scientific publishing, I think, at least in life science, I'm the chief editor of Molecular Systems Biology. The first thought is to think about big data, which is, of course, a huge issue and very early on already in the early times of genomics, and even before that with structural biology, it became apparent that the standard form of publication with papers and so on was not really adequate to present large-scale data sets, and those large-scale data sets need to be reused. And therefore, a series of public repositories were created for each data type. Nowadays, there is roughly one public repository per major data type. There are still big holes, and you see here that imaging still, these guys didn't yet manage to do a repository for imaging. This is not a laser. It's just throw. Okay, all right. Here we go. Okay, so these resources were created, so of course, to store data that could not be displayed properly and shared properly. And this is, of course, extremely useful, but it created a little bit of a paradoxical situation where the journals, the scientific literature, lives in essentially a parallel world from the databases, and they talk a little bit, usually, you know, by just providing a citation at the entire paper level, but the integration between these two worlds is actually quite tenuous, and yet the volume of scientific literature is exponentially increasing. We are above 1 million papers indexed every year in PubMed, and of course there is a plethora of publishers and journals doing essentially a similar kind of transformation, transforming Word files into XML and HTML in a highly distributed way. And these guys do not talk too much to centralized databases. Now, this is for large-scale data, and I think we tend to forget that there is a huge amount of information in papers that are actually not captured in those databases. And if we take a classical now Embo journal paper, we could take a Nature paper. Well, this is how a paper is in Cell and Molecular Biology. It's a lot of text, and of course we're talking this week a lot of about text and text mining and annotation. But also very importantly, a paper has figures where the actual data are presented. This is really where the scientific evidence that support the conclusions are presented. And this is not readily available for mining, for search, and so on. Now, it becomes a problem to find specific pieces of information and to trace down a specific piece of evidence because the volume of publication is increasing. Of course, scientific journals are an important way to disseminate information, to disseminate peer review data, and yet they are poorly machine readable. There are too many papers to be read really by humans. We completely count on computers, and there is really a disconnect between these two things. Now, a couple of years ago, we ran a survey and we said, well, to our readers, so 500 people roughly, suppose you are planning an experiment for tomorrow, you know, testing the expression of a given gene as a response to a drug administration. Would that be useful if you would have a search engine that would allow you to find whether, you know, a similar published experiment is already present in the literature, which is usually it's not that easy to check that using just PubMed. And people were saying, well, fantastic, very useful, great. But how are you going to do that? This is very difficult. And a second question we ask when you search the literature, well, what are the major issues? And what came at the top was the lack of specificity of the researchers, and it's difficult to make complex queries that are sufficiently specific so that you don't have to browse through 300 papers. Now, to make the data, so this gave us the idea that we have to make some efforts to make the published data more accessible, more searchable, more mineable. This is important for search, but eventually it is also important if we want to understand biology, and especially if it's really important if we want to somehow manage to integrate in some form high throughput data with small mechanistic molecular and cell biology data that are usually only available in the form of figures. And this was very nicely encapsulated by George Church. You know, how do we go from the genome and the craigome? This was at the time when the genome from Craig Venter was published. How do we go from that raw data to really biological understanding? And this will not go without a proper detailed mechanistic understanding. And those data usually are completely absent. So the issue we try to solve is symbolized in this experiment. I'd like to show this an experiment shown in the New England Journal of Medicine. You see the x-axis, the units, the time units is month. It goes to up to 2 years. You see that the y-axis, the measurement, is actually patients, you know, real human beings. And what is measured is their survival, therefore their death. And if you see any of this data point is actually the death of a patient. So this was a huge experiment, 700 patients. Half of them died during the experiment. The experiment lasted two years. So a very involved experiment to test the effect of combinational treatment on advanced melanoma cancer patients. Very involved in terms of amount of patient, in terms of time, in terms of resources, and even involved from the human point of view. Yet this data is available only as a little JPEG in New England Journal of Medicine. Whether New England Journal of Medicine is open access or not will not change anything. So a huge amount of very useful data that doesn't take too much space. This is would take practically no space. A huge amount of important data are just not available for reuse. So this is what we try to address. That's the idea behind the Source Data Project, to try to step by step to address this difficult problem. And Source Data is meant to be an open platform that will make the papers discoverable based on the data they contain, so such that one has direct access to the data you are interested. So we take the figures in the paper, we represent them in a structured format, we put them in a database. I represent this as a graph. It can be put in a graph database. There is a search interface for users, for humans, but also for machines, such that users can find the paper that contain the specific data that are of interest for them. So that's the idea. It's not, so it's a generous idea, but it's not very easy to do because, of course, in cell and molecular biology, the heterogeneity of the data presented in figures, especially in cell and molecular biology, is really a complete mess. And you see this is really the jungle. Everybody has a different way to present data. There are different assay types, different types of measurement, and there is really no real common theme. So it took us quite a while to think, how could we put a little bit of order in sort of what is the common theme behind all these different representations. And we tried several things, you know, without too much success, with processes and with pathways and these kind of things. And in the end, the solution, the pragmatic solution we took, looks almost trivial probably to you, but this is the way we do. We focus on individual figure panels that are much more coherent than entire figures. Entire figures are usually a mess of a mixture of all kinds of assays. And for every figure panel, we we identify the key biological entities, chemical and biological entities involved in the experiments that are mentioned in the figure legend or on the image of the figure. So that's the first step, to identify the objects if you want. And then we classify them essentially in two, simplify a bit, but essentially in two categories. Those entities that are the object of the measurements, of the observations, in this experiment we have measured the level of glucose in the blood, and those entities that are the target of an intervention, of a perturbation, experimental manipulation that is controlled and targeted. And here this experiment is comparing the effect of the deletion of the ATG5 gene, and this as a response to an insulin injection. So we have two entities here, the ATG5 gene and insulin, that have been manipulated by the experimentator in a controlled and targeted way. So, and this is really a design that comes over and over in cell and molecular biology because it gives mechanistic insights. There are two hypotheses that have been tested here. What is the effect of ATG5 and what is the effect of insulin on the level of glucose? So these relationships are very important. It sort of distilled down the essence of the experiment. And if we link now these entities to standard identifiers in the proper resources, we can assemble these relationships between entities into a graph. And behind where the nodes are the unique biological entities, the edges are at least one experiment that tested this hypothesis. And now we can search this graph and we can navigate to find the different figures that support these edges. Now, the type of entities we capture, we had to make some choice to try to cover as much as possible, but without getting completely crazy. And we chose to try to cover all the scales of biological organizations, from small molecules, genes and proteins, or gene products, cellular components, subcellular protein complexes, cell types and cell lines, tissue and organs, and full organisms. And with this, we can cover essentially all the scales in cell and molecular biology. So it doesn't represent obligatorily the entire biology, and inevitably there will be some holes, some things we cannot represent. So we still capture them as undefined, such that retrospectively we can analyze what are the gaps. So we have this knowledge graph. Now we can construct a knowledge graph like this. And I should mention that we try to link to a single major resource per entity type. Small molecules is KB, sometimes PubChem. Genes is NCBR gene, proteins UniProt. Small molecules, protein complexes in gene ontology, cellular component. Cell types and cell lines is Cellosaurus, which is a resource from the SIB. Tissues and organs, we use Uberon, and taxons, we use NCBR taxons. So these entities are normalized and linked to these resources. So we have created three tools around this concept now. A curation platform to extract this information during the publication process from the text of the figure legend. A search interface that allows now users to play around with graph and to find papers based on the experiments that have been presented in the figures. And then an application we call Smart Figures that we can inject in a paper, in the online version of a paper, such that readers can call a figure while reading the paper and connect this figure to other figures, related figures published in different papers and even in different journals. So the entire system was created with in mind the fact that we would create a workflow during the publication process. I'm an editor, so I want to do that not retrospectively, but during the publication process, whereby we take all the figures in a manuscript that is not yet accepted. We have curators in the editorial team. We had one curator is able to cover the four journals we have at Embo Press. Using our tool to process the figures, extract the information, We are starting to use now a validation interface where we can present this information back in a simplified form to authors, such that they can validate or reject or discuss the annotations, and this in principle before publication. So the curation tool is essentially a manual curation tool where each figure panel is loaded by the curator. So it is really important to do this at the single panel level. The figures would not allow to do this type of work. They are too heterogeneous. They mix assay types, they mix the different types of hypotheses that are tested. So it is really important to find the panels, or sometimes the group of panels, that represent one coherent experiment. The major source of information is the figure legend, which is tagged by the curators, and we will Lou will present more about the tagging and the pre-tagging we can do and how we would like to automate that process. But essentially, the curator has a two-dimensional menu where he can select, or she can select directly, the entity type or the experimental role, and you recognize here the intervention or the measurement. There are some additional roles that are of less importance, and I don't go into detail, but essentially that's all our knowledge model. These are just the five different experimental roles that we capture. There is then a specialized normalization interface that for each entity type will display the proper resource and prioritize the external identifier that the tool think is the most likely based on prior experience. And one thing that will be maybe important in the context of what Lou is going to present and what we try to do with PubData is that a paper can be associated to one or several species in a ranked order. And if there are exceptions in some experiments, it often happens that a paper is usually 90% done in the human system, but suddenly there is an experiment that mixes rat with mouse with human, and the curator can then specify a species that is valid only for this panel, and this accelerates a lot the curation process and not the normalization process. So you see that all these entities now here have been linked. And finally, there is a graphical summary for the curators to validate their understanding. It's very easy to make mistakes if you do curation just on the text, and if you have lists, you can really do complete nonsense. But if you put that in a sort of intuitive graphical representation, it becomes much easier to say, okay, well, this was a Western blot. What is measured? SARC P53. All right, okay, loading control actin, or what are the drugs? Is that correct? Yes, epoxomycin and the knockout of FAC. And this sort of graphical overview eliminates a lot of mistakes. Now, this is very oriented towards sort of cell and molecular biology, small scale experimentation, mechanistic biology. But we have extended also the way to do it such that we can also capture large scale experimentation where there is not only two or three or four or five objects being measured, but there are 10,000 or 100,000, which of course breaks our model. We can nevertheless capture that by paying more attention to the experimental assay that we can capture now, and we can normalize them to the bioassay ontology and OBI, ontology of biological experimentation. And then the combination of experimental assay plus the key experimental variables is actually defining the experiment pretty well. So this is a glimpse of the validation interface. Once a paper is curated, we are going to embed that in the editorial process. We have just started to do this. We are a little bit slow in doing it. And the authors then can go through each figure of their paper to see whether they agree or disagree. And one key component is, again, this graphical representation, we hope relatively intuitive, where the authors can say, well, they included this entity here as a generic biological component. Actually, it is one of the key perturbations of this thing. They can drag and drop and correct the model. And the curator receives a notification that this has been done. And at the end of the curation, the authors can also approve or reject the standard identifiers, so they will not know, of course, whether this is the proper identifier. So we display the key fields from the each resource, such that the authors have a chance to say, well, this is, you know, epoxomycin, that's actually what I meant. Because, of course, one of the key issues is whether the authors are going to do that properly or not. And this is, so we try to facilitate the task as much as possible. And we try also to initiate the system in the sense that we provide the service and the authors are asked to validate rather than the other way around. Even though in the system nothing is hardwired, and we could imagine that eventually the authors who are really enthusiastic could do the curation themselves and we would validate. So this is really open. So we have done our proof of principle by annotating, I'm never sure exactly how many, so 700 papers. This is more than 15,000. We are probably reaching now 18 or 17,000 experiments, 17,000 panels if you want. Across a bunch of journals, we have a total of 23 journals. We wanted to do that with already published papers and papers that are processed by EMBO. So this is not only EMBO journal, this contains also content from Journal of Cell Biology, Nature, Nature Communication, Cell Reports, and so on. We wanted to make a demonstration that this is, you know, broad enough and general enough to cover a lot of journals. Part of the papers are dedicated to one field, autophagy. We did that such that we have at least a set of papers where there is enough thematic overlap that we will get a connected graph. We were a little bit anxious at the beginning that we would have all kind of disparate figures not linked to each other. And the rest of the papers are just papers that we process completely randomly based on the manuscript accepted at EMBO. So on average, there are 6 to 7 figures per paper, 3 to 4 panels per figure, and 9 to 11 tags per panel. The good news is that in 80% of the cases, we have at least one relationship that involves a perturbation and a measurement. So one of these causal hypotheses, which shows that, you know, this idea of a perturbation-centric design in cell and molecular biology is very very pervasive, and we really capture a lot of the experiments. Now, importantly, even if there is no perturbation, no drug, no knockout, no siRNA, and so on, we still capture the experiment completely well. They are just a bunch of measurements that are correlative in nature. For most of the entities we tag, we can find a proper standard identifier using our 7 resources. So that was also probably a good idea. We cover, you know, in this field of cell and molecular biology, we cover really the essential of the entity types. Now, maybe a little bit less of a good news for text miners is that while a majority of the tags are indeed present in the text of the figure legend, but for a substantial amount of entities, we have to look at the figure and the label in the image to find, you know, which protein it is and so on. So these a series of tags actually do not appear in the text of the legend, but only in the image of the figure. For a human, it's not a problem. Of course, for machine, you would have to OCR the image. So there is maybe something to think about OCR, you know, joint image text mining. Yeah.
Okay. Great. Good question. So what about other parts of the paper? They may talk also about that.
Yeah. Sure. So. The sentence that cites the figure usually talks about it, or the sentence surrounding it. So these are all good tricks also to find additional information. Now, you know, we essentially try to one out of the idea behind curating figures is that it restricts your attention to the most informative part, and it turns out that the curators, they look at other parts of the paper, and we try as much as we can in the tool to link to the, you know, to the part of the text that cites the figure, but they don't really need to read the paper. They usually read the abstract to understand the global thing. They have a very good general knowledge of biology, but they don't read the full paper, and they actually don't really need it. So when you're in trouble, when you don't find something, of course you go in the text, and often also in the materials and methods. Okay, so with this, we constructed this graph that I showed. Just a few numbers. Again, the average number of synonyms, it depends on the entity types. The most sort of, you know, unstandardized are the organisms, because often they are decorated or they are named according to strain or the knockout. So often we normalize something very difficult to recognize to a specific organism when it is the object of an experimentation. One thing also is that all the entity, the distribution across the roles, the experimental role in the experimental design is not uniform. So depending on the type of entity, some entities are much more often the target of a perturbation, and some entity types are much more often the object of a measurement. And this is, you can understand that very easily. Small molecules are usually used to do perturbation with drugs, with inhibitors, and so on. Genes are the target of genetic knockouts, of overexpression experiments, of siRNA. So these are the entities that are usually manipulated in molecular biology in a controlled way, while proteins tend to be more on the side of the readouts, and so they will play the role of assays. So if you do a little bit of Bayesian thing, you can see that, you know, the probability that a small molecule is on the side of the intervention is much, much higher than random. So this is already gives you a very strong signal, and the fact that we distinguish between genes and proteins tells us already a lot about whether these entities are going to be an intervention or the target of an observation. All right, so that was for the curation tool. Now we want to do something with this information. And we wanted to show, you know, that it creates new possibility for search. So we have a search interface that is going to be improved very soon, where the users can search directed relationship and say, well, I'm interested in an experiment where the effect of insulin was tested on glucose. So it's this very object-oriented way to ask a question, but you can ask, you know, a question about an experiment that has tested a causal relationship, which is pretty nice. It returns the papers that each contain at least one or several experiments related to the query you did, and each of these experiments can be opened in the smart figure. The ranking is based on the number of repetition of this particular experiment across different assays and systems in a paper. So a paper that has tested a hypothesis 15 times with different methods is going to be ranked higher than the others. And we use also a little bit the topology of the graph to try to deduce whether a component is highly connected and may play a role that is important. I will not go into detail here. So just for the conceptual level, to show that, you know, even if an experiment has been published in a paper, this is an EMBO journal paper where an experiment testing the effect of TFEB on CLCN7 was published. If you try to do this in PubMed, there is zero result, nothing, nada. So this is really what we call the dark matter of the literature. Essentially, it reflects, of course, that PubMed doesn't have always access to the full text, but it also shows that it is actually very valuable to immediately identify the figure that shows the experiment. Google tends to be much better, of course, because it has access to the full text, but again, very often the it is hard to get to the point where you say, okay, this is the experiment I want, I remember, or this is the experiment I wanted to know. So the third application, I check the time, is smart figures, where we use essentially this search capability of experiments in the background for the users, and the users can call a figure which is displayed at the panel level. The key entities, perturbations, and object of measurements are displayed here. They are linked to the resources, so you can get more information. But then, importantly, these entities are then linked to related experiments. So there is a related data tab here that will try to identify experiments that have tested the same hypothesis or similar hypothesis as the query figure, so that if an experiment has been done already 5 times in the literature, it should be found here. And then the user can also navigate the chain of causality, see what is upstream of this entity or what is downstream of this entity by finding experiment that test the upstream or the downstream hypothesis. And thereby this smart figure is essentially a browser that allows the user from the paper, from inside the paper, to navigate the graph. So we collaborated with Wiley to do this demo site, smartfigures.net, where we have republished a couple of hundreds of papers, and we inject in the HTML content the smart figure application that can be opened while you are reading online the paper, and now start from inside the paper if you want to explore the graph of connected experiments. So this is pretty cool. I have to say, Wiley has extended our smart figure interface to also include the result of their own text mining pipeline using Temis, and this sort of we did that to sort of illustrate that manually high quality curation information can coexist with automatically processed content, and they are not obligatory mutually exclusive. If there are results with the manual curation, they are displayed. If there is nothing else, then the text mining results are shown. And in a way, they compete for each other. And eventually, if those strategies are used and they would be user data, we can see what the users are really using. Okay, so there is an open API to source data that allows to access the public content of the database. These are roughly, I think, 500 or 600 papers. You can access to the annotation, to the individual panels, also to some of the search functions. The way we keep the annotation at the moment is essentially as tagged XML or tagged HTML. We have a little SD tag element, and the attributes essentially capture the semantics, the role, the type, the resource that is linked to with a standard identifier. So that's a very pragmatic, simple way we keep these things as HTML or XML, because we need to redisplay them in the context of styling elements. So if there are elements that have HTML styling elements, we need to keep that. We cannot just extract completely the text and forget about that. And then we can put that back in the XML source of the paper, adding a SD panel element to the normal caption element in the XML. For example, in the JATS XML for those who use that. So it's not a standard, but it's our pragmatic way to deal with that stuff. I mean, and certainly Lou can talk about that better. But if in the course of the week there are ideas, or if we can even start working to transform these kind of things into BioC or PUMB annotation, that would be very useful. Now, a few words as a perspective. We have talked about how to extract what kind of metadata, descriptive metadata, we can extract from the figures, and how this can be used for search and to search essentially papers based on the data, the content they contain. Now, the initial issue I was mentioning, that the data behind the figures is usually not available, remain unaddressed, and we would like now, if you want to close the loops such that we can search papers based on the data they contain, but then also download the actual data, and not only the image of the figure. And this is quite important. It's, of course, important to advance science and to reuse data. It's also, it becomes more important because of issues we see every day at the journals related to data integrity. And we see faked images, we see faked, manipulated blots and so on. And requesting from authors to provide the data behind the figure is already, putting some pressure, and usually the authors do it, and it sort of makes the entire paper more transparent. I would have dozens of slides to show. It's very entertaining with a lot of a lot of examples. I just show this one, which was very instructive. Of course, you know Dr. Yamanaka, Nobel Prize for stem cells, and he had a paper in 2000 in the Embo Journal where there was these bands, and some people were starting to claim, oh, this is fake data. You know, these bands are similar, and so on and so on. And actually, when our experts looked at this data, it was you could not really conclude whether these data were, you know, you could not conclude that these two bands are similar. It's very, very difficult to make a decision whether, you know, two images are identical or not, based on what, based on what expectation. And we had a good editorial from our chief editor at Embo Journal, says, you know, there is no definitive evidence that this is, and therefore we are not going to retract any paper because of suspicion. and this was a difficult time for Dr. Yamanaka, because he had to apologize because he didn't have the, you know, these blots from 10 or 15 years ago, they didn't have them anymore. And I think this would happen in many, many labs over the world, that the data was not available anymore, the high resolution. And that was very difficult. Yeah. And all of that could have been avoided by providing the data behind the figure in the paper, such that it can be downloaded later. So this is one of the I wanted to tell this story as one example, a rather dramatic example. Now, since a couple of years, and we started that at molecular systems biology, but Embo Journal is doing the same, we ask authors to provide the source data behind the figure. And this is where the entire name of the project is coming from, actually. And authors do that really gladly. We have 60-70% of natural compliance. We don't enforce that, and we ask. And if there are quantitative data in MSB, we ask for the Excel table that provides the numerical value. So there is no real standard for that, but at least a reader who understands the paper can download and reuse. So now we would like to combine the two things, provide the data behind the figures, annotate it properly, and distribute that through the source data interface. So now we have a functionality to upload those files to the source data curation tool once the figure has been annotated. And now on the user side, users can download the entire figure. It's essentially a data package that contains the image, the tagged text, the tagged XML with all the semantic information, a JSON file that explains that provides the list of all the identifiers, but also the data table. Okay, so this is the concept for the future, that we would like to publish figures, not only as little images, but as integrated data packages that contain the human readable version of the figure and the data and the code. So this is our now priority for the future. We want to integrate better with existing data standards for quantitative biology, but also imaging, possibly omics, and try to link to external databases. I should say, we don't really want to upload data to the source data resource. We prefer to link to existing resources, and we can already do it. So we try to collaborate now with BioStudies, for example, to link to data sets they would host there. And of course, in the context of this meeting, to improve automation. So automation of the entire process in the context of a supervised curation, supervised at least by the authors who would have to validate. So this puts a little bit different constraints than trying to do automation to mine 1 million papers de novo, which is much much more difficult. So this is the future. This is not the reality, right? So just to make it clear, but the step in the automation in would involve segmenting the image into the panels, segmenting the text of the figure caption into the caption of the panel, doing named entity recognition and associating normalizing that to the standard identifiers, at least for a subset of entity types we have. Some are probably easier to do than others, and probably the low hanging fruit are small molecules, gene and gene products, and So most of the time of the curators go in the normalization, which is a difficult process. And finally, that would be the most beautiful is, of course, to try to form the text or the image or a combination of both to do the inference of the experimental design, such that we can extract from a description of this experiment here the fact that this experiment describes that MIC influences potentially CKS1, etc. So how to do this? I don't know, but I'm just showing here something I have been doing in the last weeks. It is more of a demo and a game, but it's more to stimulate your comment and suggestion. So to segment the text of the full legend into the panels, I used a simple convolution network approach at the character level, where the text is encoded, fed into a convergent convolution layer, and then fed in a divergent convolution layer, such that there is perfect alignment between the two layers, and then the output is essentially the position of the panel boundary. And there are different variations. I tested different architecture, more or less sophisticated. This is how it looks. So if you have the text here, even if there are things like, you know, something else not shown in panel A and then C to G, so if you know this panel delimitation in the papers across the different journals is quite messy. So it essentially performs, you know, flexible pattern recognition. Instead of using regex, it uses this simple convolution, and it seems to work pretty well. So 80% recall and 90% accuracy, at least on the data set we have. So I just wanted to show that to have maybe more ideas. The architecture can be made deeper and more complicated, maybe for other, you know, contexts, like trying to infer the role of entities, but this, we are not there. So I hope that with this resource, we facilitate the discovery of papers and data. We combine discoverability with data availability from the side of the authors, and I think we bridge now the literature to the open data and open science world, such that, you know, people can reuse really the data that are behind the papers, and that authors are somehow motivated to provide data because they will be a better discoverer. So you can check our website. You have access here to all the demos. And we do this with funding from the Robert Bosch Stiftung in Germany. It was a 3-year project. Collaborate with Wiley. And these are the people who did the work. We collaborate with the Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics. Lou is here. She's going to talk in 2 minutes. Robin Isaac worked also on the project. And Sarah and Nancy are the curators who curated all the papers. Thanks. Thank you very much.